Voting can be complicated. LAist is here to help. Check out LAist's Voter Game Plan, the fact-based voter guide that will give you the tools you need to navigate your ballot. Visit VoterGamePlan at LAist.com/vote. LAist and Show and Tell present an evening with David Sedaris. The writer, humorist, and radio contributor will take the stage Saturday, November 16th at the United Theater on Broadway. Tickets and information at LAist.com/events.
It's time for TV Talk, and joining us is Liz Shannon Miller, Senior Entertainment Editor at Consequence, and making her debut with us on the program, Saloni Gudger, who is staff writer covering television for the AV Club. Saloni and Liz, so good to have you both with us. We're going to talk about the Emmys in a little bit, but let's start with the Starz series Three Women. Three Women, starring Shailene Woodley, DeWanda Wise, Gabrielle Creevy. The series is created by Lisa Tadeo, who wrote the book that it's adapted from. Liz, what do you think of Three Women on Starz?
So this is a show I really wish I had loved. Unfortunately, it's a little bogged down in what feels like kind of reheated feminism. The premise of the story is that, you know, these are, you know, a writer is basically pinpointing three different women whose stories she feels represent the great swaths of humanity that, you know, identify as female and are trying to figure out how to be happy in today's world. It's a really, you know, the performances are amazing. You've got the cast is pretty top notch and they're all really committed to their roles. And it's a very sexual show as well, if that's a thing that makes you more interested. There's a lot of nudity, a lot of sexual content. But a lot of its themes just kind of feel, as I mentioned, a little reheated and, you know, could have been, it feels like it doesn't move the conversation necessarily forward in the ways in which women and sex interact in today's world.
Three Women on Starz premieres tomorrow at 7 o'clock, and then we'll have episodes that release weekly for a total of 10 episodes of Three Women. How to Die Alone stars Natasha Rothwell, Conrad Ricamora, and Jocko Sims. Rothwell is the creator as well as star of the series. Saloni.
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, I think, for me, Natasha Rothwell is such a star. She's already proven just how funny she is on Insecure. She was on season one of The White Lotus. And I think with How to Die Alone, she really has figured out a really great way to not just, bring both those elements together, but to tell a really lovely, wholesome story. She plays Mel, who works at an airport. And, you know, ironically, she is very afraid of flying. In fact, I think she struggled with a lot of things that scare her in the whole show, or the first season, which consists of 8 episodes, is about her trying to overcome everything that scares her. And I think in the beginning, it seems like the show is trying to do too much because it's a workplace comedy. It has some rom-com tropes, but I think it succeeds when it is an adult coming of age story, and Natasha Rothwell is so funny, so great. So I'm excited for people to see it. And you know, I spoke to her recently, and she said that she has a 4-season plan for the show. So I hope people see it, and she's able to do all 4 seasons of it.
All right, we'll get your notifications turned off there, so we don't have that coming through again. Liz, what did you think of How to Die Alone?
I really enjoyed it. I've only seen the first few episodes, but I think what I really responded to is just like, you know, it really does feel like a strong point of view coming from Natasha Rothwell. And I also really loved Conrad Nicomora as her best friend, who was a really fun presence in the Hulu movie Fire Island. And is playing a very different character in this. So it's really exciting to see him show that kind of range.
We're talking about How to Die Alone, which is streaming on Hulu. The comedy's first 4 episodes premiere tomorrow, then additional episodes release weekly for a total of 8 in the series. The Penguin, following the events of Matt Reeves, The Penguin and Colin Farrell stars, Kristen Milioti in the cast as well. First episode premiering tomorrow at 6 o'clock Pacific on HBO. And it, of course, also will be streaming on Max. Liz, please tell us about The Penguin.
So I started watching The Penguin after watching the new documentary about The Sopranos. And so maybe it was a little hard for me to get Tony Soprano's voice out of my head while I was watching this. But that's a credit to The Penguin, frankly. The Penguin is a really solid continuation of what was started in The Batman, but it's really its own story. It's a crime drama. It's a mob drama. And then you've also got Kristen Bellotti in there just playing an amazing character that she's clearly having the time of her life with. She's unhinged. She's scary. She's got a little smile on her face. It's really incredible work from her.
All right. Saloni, what do you think of The Penguin?
Hi. Yeah, I thought the same. I feel like more than Colin Farrell, I'm very excited for everyone to see Kristen Milioti. I think it's a much better show when it focuses on the origin story of her character, Sofia Falcone, who is a villain in her own right. Another really cool Batman character who I don't think we've seen so much in a live adaptation. So I'm excited for that. And she is great. She's always been great in a lot of other projects, How I Met Your Mother, Palm Springs, but I don't think we've seen her do something like this because she's a villain, even if she's kind of on her own path for revenge. And I think she really goes toe to toe with Colin Farrell on the show. I'm still not a big fan of the Penguin using a fat suit for him. And so I do hope people tune in and really take a lot out of Kristen Milioti's performance.
We're talking about go ahead.
Just one thing I want to mention about The Penguin. It really is a direct continuation from The Batman. So if you're excited about watching The Penguin, I would put aside 3 hours and watch or rewatch The Batman first.
All right. Good advice. The Penguin premiering on HBO this Sunday at 6 o'clock Pacific, episodes releasing weekly. There will be a total of 8. And of course, right after its HBO airing, it's streaming on Max. The Penguin starring Colin Farrell and Kristen Milioti. High Potential is an ABC series also streaming on Hulu. It stars Caitlin Olsen and Daniel Sunjata. Drew Goddard created the series, and it's based on a French series, High Potential. Liz?
Yeah, so, you know, broadcast television loves its consulting detectives, and this one's a really eccentric one. Caitlin Olsen basically brings a lot of the same energy you maybe recognize from It's Always Sunny, but she's playing a harried single mom, and she's really engaged with that character, and there's a really great rapport between her and the rest of the cast. I think there's a lot going on in terms of like showing how smart she is through lots of flashing to various, flashing to various like documentary clips and newsreel footage and so forth. And it sometimes that feels like it bogs things down a little bit, but it's still like a solid entry in the unconventional detective help solve crime genre, which is a really fun one, I think.
High Potential, again, airing on the ABC network. It premieres next Tuesday, September 17th at 7 o'clock Pacific time. I don't think that's probably right because that's not prime time for ABC. We'll double check the time of that airing, but it'll be next Tuesday on ABC, also streaming on Hulu. There'll be 10 episodes total. It's probably at 10 o'clock, I'm guessing, on ABC next Tuesday. Emily in Paris, season 4 now with the second part of season 4 on Netflix, the series created by Darren Star. Lily Collins stars. Saloni, what do you think of the newest release of episodes of Emily in Paris?
Yeah, I think that, you know, a show like Emily in Paris, which is so unserious, so beautiful, has a place on TV because it's such a mindless entertainer, and that's how the show has survived for 4 seasons. But I think in the latest batch of episodes, the show really tries to somewhat minutely challenge itself, and I think it's kind of better off for it. It's still very silly, it's still very absurd, but by the time it ends and sets up a potential 5th season, I think the show is trying to grow up a little bit, and I think I appreciate that Lily Collins gets to perform just slightly more, because of that. She's obviously still wearing impeccable outfits, but I think she gets to show some more emotional range as Emily processes some life changes. So I appreciated a show like Emily in Paris trying to evolve, at least just a little bit.
Are there people that hate watch this? I've heard
absolutely.
That.
I think I think absolutely, because you know, you can just turn your brain off, and it's perfect escapism. I think that's its best quality, if that's what we want to call it. You can just hide away in her, you know, perfect Paris line for a little while and hate watch everything. But I think I, you know, surprisingly, it by the end of four, you know, she moves away from Paris just a little bit, and I think that charges the show in a different way.
Emily in Paris, part two of season four is streaming on Netflix. The final five episodes of this season four season are releasing today. And I just wanted to mention, with High Potential, the previous series starring Caitlin Olsen, we're talking about it, is 10 o'clock on ABC7 and other ABC West Coast stations, streaming on Hulu as well for the 10 episodes there. Terminator Zero is an anime action film created by Mattson Tomlin. Liz, what do you think of Terminator Zero?
It's fun. So, you know, there have been so many different permutations of the Terminator franchise. There have been so many different looks at, you know, at that particular universe. This is a kind of unconventional one. It's focusing on new characters. It creates a whole new scenario to check out. And it's got a really outstanding voice cast. You know, you can't go wrong with Timothy Oliphant. And you know, there's a, it also approaches, it approaches the, you know, the past and the present in really interesting ways. Basically by, you know, finding a new angle on the Skynet story to explore.
All right. We're talking about Terminator Zero, the anime series. It's rated TVMA. All eight episodes are available now on Netflix. Only Murders in the Building is right in the midst of season four. I think the third episode is out this week, if I recall, starring, of course, Steve Martin, Selena Gomez, and Martin Short. Saloni, what do you think about season four?
You're right. So the fourth episode actually came out this week. And I do think that, you're right. The third episode, I mean. And I think that this season is really great when it focuses on the three leads that you just mentioned. And that kind of is the appeal of the show, their wholesome, unexpected dynamic. There's a ton of guest stars this season because, you know, Hollywood comes to the Arconia to make a movie on their lives in the podcast. Sometimes I think that dilutes the charm of the show, but it's still very fun because, you know, you're getting to see Martin Short and Steve Martin and Selena Gomez interact with Meryl Streep or Eva Longoria. And so I think if you're a big fan of watching them, you know, in this extremely cute dynamic and seeing them solve murders, but also their scope expands, the world expands of the show a little bit. It comes with its own challenges that I think the show is still figuring out. But in the end, it's still a lot of fun. I'm still getting used to it not being in Arconia the whole time because it moves to LA a little bit from time to time. But I think if you're a fan of the show already, there isn't too much to complain about. You'll get used to it.
And Jane Lynch, I don't think this is a spoiler to say that she gets killed, but that doesn't mean she's not available for the series this season, which is nice and always great to see her work as well. Only Murders in the Building in its fourth season, streaming on Hulu. Three episodes are out. Every episode, new episode comes out weekly on Tuesdays. There will be a total of 10 of them. When we come back, we'll talk about the Emmy Awards to be given out this Sunday evening on ABC television. I want to hear what our TV critics have to say about who they're rooting for. We'll be back in just 1 minute with our TV talk critics on Film Week, on Air Talk. We continue with our Film Week critics to get their thoughts about the upcoming Emmy Awards. With us making her debut on TV Talk on Air Talk is Saloni Gudger and Liz Shannon Miller with us as well. So the Emmy Awards, 76th annual, to be given out at the Peacock Theater at LA Live downtown this Sunday, 5 o'clock Pacific. ABC is the telecaster of the event. It's the second Emmys to air this year because of the writers and actors' strikes, which, of course, delayed the previous year's show. And the hosts are the father-son duo, and Emmy winners Eugene and Dan Levy will be the hosts. And the big nominee garnerers were Shogun and The Bear, both from Hulu, Only Murders in the Building as well, True Detective, Night Country, and The Crown. Liz, let me start with you. What are you really hoping might be an upset here, something that you're really personally pulling for? Maybe it, you know, might not be a favorite, but you think is really worthy.
You know, it's a great question. I feel like, you know, we've got so many like established shows in the mix at this point that I'd love to see something like Hacks take the best comedy prize. I think you can get into the whole question of whether or not The Bear even is a comedy, though this is being reviewed. The Bear is nominated here for season two. So that's the season you need to think about. Not a great season,
even though it's not really a comedy.
Exactly. So, I mean, I wouldn't be mad if The Bear won in the comedy category, but at the same time, Hacks, Reservation Dogs, this is the last season for Reservation Dogs that will ever exist. So this is its last chance to win, and it's such a deserving winner if it does.
Yeah, and Jean Smart, of course, with Hacks, well-written series, and she is absolutely extraordinary. Saloni, for you, what are you rooting for that maybe is not a favorite, but you think's worthy?
Yeah, I definitely agree that Reservation Dogs, I think, should be the FX show to kind of sweep it because it's the last time they can do it. But I think even, you know, besides that, my big thing with the Emmys has been that we kind of tend to zero in on shows. You know, there's a lot of sweeps happening. I expect it again with Shogun in the drama category this year and, you know, The Bear in comedy. And they're both great shows, so they deserve it and I'm happy. But personally, I would just love to see Emmy voters watching TV, expanding their scope to honor, you know, the wide variety of it. And as for winners, there's, you know, I'm really rooting for Janelle James from Abbott Elementary in the supporting category. I think she is so funny. Every line that she delivers, you know, makes people laugh. And I think it really, giving her the award would really be celebrating comedy. And, you know, as always, I'm just baffled that The Morning Show has secured so many nominations. But Billy Crudup is great, and he kind of makes that show even when no one else does. So in the supporting categories, I feel like those are two of my random favorites who I hope win.
Yeah, I think, Saloni, one of the problems with Abbott Elementary is that is such a great cast. There's so many terrific performances. You know, Quinta Brunson, Cheryl Lee Ralph, and Cheryl Lee, I think, has been a former winner, if I'm not mistaken.
He has, yes.
But Janelle James has created a character who I would put in the category of one of the great comedic standout characters in the history of television comedy. I think it's that much a breakout, hilarious character. And I agree, it would be wonderful to see her honored, a tremendous talent and a very well-written character as well.
It could be so one note, but she has transformed the character so much, especially in this past season. So I do hope that she gets to a win for it.
We're talking with Saloni Gudger, who is staff writer covering TV at the AV Club, Liz Shannon Miller, senior entertainment editor at Consequence. Liz, what's your sense of viewer interest in the Emmy? So many of these awards shows have really seen a decline of interest, and people love watching streaming television, but it seems like award shows have lost a bit of their appeal.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Emmys have always struggled to have like the same cultural significance that the Oscars do. Like, if you compare the amount of scholarship that's been written about Emmys history versus Oscars history, the difference is vast. It's actually, there's barely anything about the Emmys as an awards body going back to its origins. So I think, like, I mean, it's tough because I think there will be interest. I think the Eugene and Dan Levy being paired like might have been more exciting when Schitt's Creek was at its heyday.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's still, I think, going to be, I think people still have really fond memories of that show. So at least they as a hosting pair will be really fun to watch.
Liz Shannon Miller of Consequence, Saloni Gudger of AV Club, thank you both so much for giving us your television reviews and talking about the Emmy Awards coming up this Sunday, 5 o'clock on ABC.
LAist and Show and Tell present An Evening with David Sedaris. The humorist, comedian, author, and radio contributor will take the stage at the United Theater on Broadway to share insights, read from both published and unpublished work, and host a live Q&A with the audience, followed by a book signing. It's Saturday, November 16th at the United Theater. Tickets and information at laist.com/events.